إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم تسليما كثيرا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله. Indeed, the most truthful of speech is the book of Allah. وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. And the best guidance we have is the guidance of our beloved messenger Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. وشر الأمور محدثاتها. And the worst of affairs are those things we newly invent into this religion of ours. وكل محدثة بدعة. And everything we newly invent into this deen of ours is an innovation. وكل بدعة ضلالة. And every innovation is misguidance and it leads astray. وكل ضلالة في النار. And every going astray, every misguidance is in the hellfire. ثم أما بعد. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, last week as we focused on the Salah and the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, رأس الأمر الإسلام وعموده الصلاة, that the matter that concerns us is Islam and its pillar is the prayer. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He gave us something specific within this prayer. One of the greatest things that the Muslim can do, and if they do it correctly, they will have much reward. And it is the sajda, specifically the sajda with respect to the prayer. So do not let any one of your prayers go by without you making sajda, prostrating on the ground with humility, with except that you have calmness and tranquility, humility and peace while you're in it. Now just think of this sajda, you're putting your face, the face that we all protect, the face that we all care about, right? If you're going to get hit, most of us will protect the face. You're putting that face on the ground, whispering, praising your Lord, glorifying Him and making dua to Him. Yet even though He's above the seven heavens, above His arsh, separate from His creation, He hears you and everything you're saying. And this was something that all of the anbiya, all of the prophets and all of the righteous people did. Allah Azza wa Jalla, He said, Muhammadan Rasulullah, وَالَّذِينَ مَعْهُ أَشِدَّاءُ عَلَى الْكُفَّارِ رُحَمَاءُ بَيْنَهُمْ تَرَاهُمْ رُكَّعًا سُجَّدًا يَبْتَغُونَ فَضْلًا مِنَ اللَّهِ وَرِضْوَانًا سِيمَاهُمْ فِي وُجُوهِهِمْ مِنْ أَثَرِ السُّجُودِ ذَلِكَ مَثَلُهُمْ فِي التَّوْرَاةِ وَمَثَلُهُمْ فِي الْإِنْجِيلِ. Allah Azza wa Jalla said what means Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the messenger of Allah, and those who are with him are severe against the disbelievers and merciful amongst themselves. You see them bowing, you see them making sajda, falling prostrate in prayer, seeking the bounty from Allah and His good pleasure. The mark of them, of their faith, is on their faces, on their foreheads, from the traces of their prostration, from the traces of their sujood. This is their description in the Torah. So this was the way of prayer commanded through all time. This was the description of in Torah and the similar description in the Injil. Like a sown seed which sends forth its shoot, then it makes it strong and it becomes thick and it stands straight on the stem, delighting the sowers that he may enrage the disbelievers with them. وَعَدَ اللَّهَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ مِنْهُمْ مَغْفِرَةً وَأَجْرًا عَظِيمًا. And Allah has promised those amongst them who believe, that they believe in Tawheed, in the religion of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam till the day of resurrection, and do righteous good deeds, that they will have forgiveness and a mighty reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. ثم قال الله: أولئك الذين أنعم الله عليهم من النبيين من ذرية آدم وممن حملنا مع نوح ومن ذرية إبراهيم وإسرائيل وممن هدينا واجتبينا إذا تتلى عليهم آيات الرحمن خروا سجدا وبكيا. Allah says, what means? Those were they unto whom Allah bestowed His grace from amongst the prophets, the offspring of Adam, and of those whom we carried in the ship with Nuh alayhi salam, and the offspring of Ibrahim and Israel. And Israel is not a country. Israel, when it's mentioned in the Quran, like Bani Israel, this is another name for Prophet Yaqub, for Prophet Jacob. So when it's mentioned Israel, this is the offspring of Yaqub. And from amongst those whom we guided and chose, when the verses of Ar-Rahman were revealed unto them and recited unto them, they fell down prostrating and weeping. So the sajda has always been a way to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, my brothers and sisters in Islam, realize that Allah, He commanded you with this sajda, and it is a source of you to be successful in this life and the next. Allah says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اركعوا واسجدوا واعبدوا ربكم وافعلوا الخير لعلكم تفلحون. Allah says, what means? O you who believe, bow down and prostrate yourselves. Again, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, if you want to be from the believers, you must be of those who bow down and prostrate yourselves to Allah and worship your Lord and do good so that you may be successful. Yet there are some who ignore this command, or they do it for show off, or they do it to please the people or for the people to talk about them. But subhanAllah, Yawm al-Qiyamah, the day that is 50,000 years long, Yawm al-Qiyamah miqdaruhu 50 al-fasana, their situation will be different than the believers. Allah says, Yawm yakshafu an saqin wa yud'auna ila sujudi fala yastati'un. The day of resurrection, the day where the shin of Allah will be laid bare, and the people will be called to make sajda, but those hypocrites will not be able to do so. One of the greatest gifts we've been given, a mercy, a blessing, yet we see some who look at the sajda and the salah like it's a burden, or like it's something hard to do, or they look at it in such a thing that it's dreadful, something that they want to rush through so they can get back to their dunya. وَالْعَيَادُ بِاللَّهِ. But it's of the greatest gifts. And it is a mercy that we are able to praise our Lord and worship Him in this way. Allah says, أَلَمْ تَرَ أَنَّ اللَّهَ يَسْجُدُ لَهُ مَنْ فِي السَّمَوَاتِ وَمَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَالشَّمْسُ وَالْقَمَرُ وَالنُّجُومُ وَالْجِبَالُ وَالشَّجَرُ وَالدَّوَابُّ وَكَثِيرٌ مِنَ النَّاسِ وَكَثِيرٌ حَقَّ عَلَيْهِ الْعَذَابُ وَمَنْ يُهِنِ اللَّهُ فَمَا لَهُ مِنْ مُكْرِمٍ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَفْعَلُ مَا يَشَاءُ. Allah says, what means? See you not that to Allah prostrates whatever is in the heavens and the earth. Whatever is in the heavens and the earth makes sajda. The sun, the moon, the stars, the mountains, the trees, all of the living creatures, and many of mankind. But there are many men whom don't do so, and punishment is justified for them. And whoever Allah disgraces, there's none who can honor Him. Verily, Allah does what He wills. Honor from Allah Azza wa Jal will come from being of those who believe and hold fast to Tawheed and the Aqeedah of our righteous predecessors. And they establish the Salah as the Prophet ﷺ established the Salah. So be of those who make sajda, mukhlisan, sincerely for the face of Allah, so that Allah honors you. So the question to ask yourself, to reach this elevation and this status, to make sajda purely for Allah Azza wa Jal, to reach that status of those who are successful, you must question how you make your sujood, and do you benefit from it? Because every sajda you can make is a treasure, a gift. Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, he said that the souls of the people are brought closer to Allah during sajda. The souls of the people are brought closer to Allah during sajda. So sujood is one of the greatest things that the Muslim can do. And it's the thing that shaitan, Iblis, would not do, and it destroyed him forever. Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, he said, وَالسُّجُودُ سِرُّ الصَّلَاةِ وَرُكْنُهَا الْأَعْظَمُ وَخَاتَمَ الرَّكْعَةِ وَمَا قَبْلَهُ مِنَ الْأَرْكَانِ كَالْمُقَدَّمَاتِ لَهُ. Ibn al-Qayyim, he said, sujood, the prostration, is the secret of the prayer. It is the pillar of the prayer, the main pillar, the greatest pillar of the prayer is the sajda. And it is the seal of your rak'ah, the seal of your unit of prayer. He said all the other actions you did before it were just a prelude, to that sajda. So we should reflect, when we go into sujood, what do we feel? Are we just doing the motion to get it out of the way to end our salah? Or do we try to do it with humility? Worshipping Allah with ihsan. And what is ihsan? We learn from the hadith. أَن تَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ كَأَنَّكَ تَرَاهُ فَإِن لَمْ تَكُنْ تَرَاهُ فَهُوَ يَرَاهُ. Is that you worship Allah as if you see Him, but knowing that you do not see Allah, you know that He sees you. When you make sajda with this consciousness that Allah is watching you, listening to you, seeing you, then you will do it in a state of humility. So you must look at your prayer, how you do it. Do you make dua? Do you call upon your Lord? Do you weep in your sajda, asking and begging Allah Azza wa Jal? My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, we have gotten to look for happiness in ways that are actually more difficult for us to attain, and ways that are empty. Because you see people searching for fame, for happiness, money, for happiness, prosperity, for happiness. Yet, they all fail. The actors, the actresses, the athletes, the richest of the people, committing suicide, getting into drugs, getting into alcohol, getting into depression, getting into anxiety. But Allah, He said the true happiness. He gave us the sajda, and this is where true happiness lies. Why? Because you can become close to your Lord in that sense. When you're in sajda, calling upon Him, getting His aid and His support. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أقرب ما يكون العبد من ربه أقرب ما يكون العبد من ربه وهو ساجد فأكثر الدعاء رواه مسلم. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said that the closest a servant is to his Lord is when he's in sajda. So make more dua when you're in sajda. Make dua when you're in sajda. I've had some question be told that they could not make dua in sajda. And here you have authentic hadith after authentic hadith. So make dua while you're in sajda. You are the closest to your Lord, to His pleasure, to His guidance, to His help, to His aid, to His comfort, to His assistance, for Him to strengthen you. It's in that sajda. So we literally choose sometimes to make that sajda 2 seconds, or 1 second, or 5 seconds. Yet if you have the person you loved in this dunya, whether it be your spouse or your parents or your child or whoever it may be, you would want every waking minute by them alive for you to spend with them, to be close to them. You wouldn't want them to leave. You cry when they get on a plane because they're going on a trip. Yet here you have the Lord of the heavens and the earth, your Creator, who's blessed you with blessings you could never count. وَإِنْ تَعُدُّ نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا. If you try to enumerate the blessings of Allah, you would never be able to count them. And in sajda, you're closest to Him in that sense. That He will aid you and protect you even though He's above His throne, above the 7 heavens, separate from His creation. And yet you'll spend 1 or 2 seconds or 5 seconds there. So how does that make sense for someone who claims they love Allah? But you'll spend hours on other things you love of this dunya that will not benefit you yawm al-qiyamah. The more you humble yourself in sujood, the closer you get to Allah, and indeed He will elevate you. كَمَا قَالَ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ مَنْ تَوَاضَعَ لِلَّهِ رَفَعَهُ. Whoever is humble before Allah, has humility before Allah, Allah will raise him and elevate his status and raise him in degrees. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ما من عبد يسجد لله سجدة إلا كتب الله له بها حسنة ومحى عنه بها سيئة ورفع له بها درجة فاستكثروا من السجود. عباد بن الصامت رضي الله عنه, he heard the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم say, no one prostrates to Allah, makes a sajda to Allah, except that Allah will give him one hasana, one reward, and remove one sin or evil deed, and He will raise him up one degree. So the Prophet ﷺ commanded us, so make more sujood. And this means pray your extra prayers, not make these extra sujood that the people have innovated into, and we'll mention that shortly. And this hadith is authentic. The more you prostrate to Allah, He'll raise your ranks in paradise. So you can be ma'an nabiyyin, you can be with the prophets, you can be with Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam فردوس الفردوس الأعلى in جنة, the highest of Jannah, where the roof of your home will be عرش الرحمن, the throne of the most merciful. So how can you get to that level? ربيع بن كعب رضي الله عنه, he was with the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم one evening. He said, كنت أبيت مع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فأتيته بوضوئه وحاجته. I was with the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم one evening. So I brought him the water for wudu and I brought him, gave him what he needed. فَقَالَ لِي سَلْمِ He told me, ask of me, O Rabi'a, ask of me. فَقَالَ He said, فَقُلْتُ In the hadith, فَقُلْتُ أَسْأَلُكَ مَرَافَقَةً فِي الْجَنَّةِ I asked to be your companion in paradise. فَقَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهِ وَسَلَمْ أَوْ غَيْرَ ذَلِكَ Anything other than this? قَالَ رَبِيعَ هُوَ ذَاتْ هُوَ ذَاتْ This is what I want, هُوَ ذَاتْ This is all I want, is to be your companion in paradise. فَقَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهِ وَسَلَمْ فَأَعِنِّي عَلَى نَفْسِكَ بِكَثْرَةِ السُّجُودِ Help me to let you achieve this highest place in Jannah where you can be my companion by كَثْرَةِ السُّجُودِ Doing more sujood, يعني more nawafil prayers, more nafil prayers. The extra prayers, and this hadith is in Sahih Muslim. The extra prayers. And look at how أعني على نفسك بكثرة السجود. The sujood is being referred to as the prayer. If it doesn't show you its grandeur, its greatness of the arkan of the pillars of the prayer, if another hadith doesn't, this one does. So this is for us to know also. Some people will make a sajda after every fard prayer. And this is a bid'ah. It is an innovation. It was not found to be from the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, nor his companions, nor the tabi'een, nor the tabi'een. So leave off that sajda after prayer that you would just do. يعني as ibadah. Because it is not from the sunnah of the best of mankind. قال الله عز وجل سيماهم في وجوههم من أثر السجود. Allah said their marks on their faces are from the traces of prostration. Some people think this is a mark on someone's forehead that actually physically marks their head or their forehead. And this is incorrect. Mujahid, one of the famous mufassirin, he stated that the marks refer to the marks of khushu', of humility, that come from the khushu'. These are what those marks are. The devotion you give to the salah, to loving Allah, to sacrificing this dunya so you can have Jannah. But in the akhirah, these traces of prostration are described as being a light or a radiance by which the people will be recognized. May Allah make us of those who have those radiant faces because of our sujood. They love the sajda. They love the sajda. They never want to be deprived of being able to make it. When they're hurt, they even try to make it because they don't want to lose it. They don't want to give it up. Their heart, even when they're not in sajda, it's still in sajda. Because they know that's the greatest of the pillars of the prayer. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, this sajda is so important. And at other times it's legislated outside of salah. Like when you're reading Quran, you get to that, يعني the ayat of tilawah, where the sajda is mandated. Or it's recommended. If you don't do it, it's not a sin upon you, but it's of course highly recommended. The prostration is so important, and shaitan, at least he hates it for us. Because he was commanded to do it and he didn't do so. So he goes and he weeps. عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا قرأ ابن آدم السجدة فسجد اعتزل الشيطان يبكي يقول يا ويله أمر ابن آدم بالسجود فسجدت له الجنة وأمرت بالسجود فأبيت فلي النار Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said in authentic hadith, he said when a son of Adam makes sajda, because he reads a verse of sajda and he prostrates, shaitan, he runs away into seclusion, weeping and crying. And he says, woe to me. This day I'm humiliated because the son of Adam was commanded to make sajda. And he made sajda, for him is Jannah. And I was commanded to make one sajda, and I refused the command of Allah. So for me is the hellfire. And this hadith is Sahih in the Sunnah of Ibn Majah. Now imagine what we're commanded to do in the day. Five prayers.
Two rak'ahs, four, four, three and four. That's 34 sujood if you just do the fard prayers. Iblis was destroyed from not doing one. And some of us don't do 34 a day. And these sujood, they're owed to Allah. Without him even deserving, without us even deserving to be rewarded for that. Just to praise him and to thank him and to glorify his name for what he's blessed us with of blessings and favors. عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم تأكل النار ابن آدم إلا أثر السجود حرم الله على النار أن تأكل أثر السجود رواه ابن ماجه وهذا حديث صحيح. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, the fire of Jahannam. So this, for all of you who have that mindset of, I can't pray because I'm sinning so much. Again, we said last week, we'll say it again. This is shaitan trying to get you to give up your deen. Because as the Sahaba were in consensus, if you leave the salah, you exit Islam. So shaitan tries to make you feel so desperate and hopeless like you will never be forgiven. Even if you're committing every sin, even if you're going to go to the hellfire, if you have tawheed, you can make it out of Jahannam. But look at this hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. He said, the fire will consume all of the son of Adam except the marks of sujood. Except the marks of your prostration. Allah has forbidden the fire to consume the marks of your prostration. So if you were to go to Jahannam for even one bit, وَلَعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ may Allah protect us from even feeling its heat over the sirat, over the bridge of Jahannam. If you were to go to it, the fire cannot burn your forehead and your nose, or the palms of your hands, or your knees or your toes. Because these are the traces of your prostration, the marks of your prostration. So never despair, always come to the salah so you don't cut off your connection with Allah Azza wa Jalla. And Anas ibn Malik, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أمرنا عفوا قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم اعتدلوا في السجود ولا يبسط أحدكم ذراعيه انبساط الكلب رواه البخاري. Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, be straight in your sujood. Now this is how to do it correctly. Be straight in it, meaning when you're making sajda, do not do so in a way where your tummy is against your thighs and the back of your thighs are against your calves. Be straight, let your back be straight and let it settle. Don't just touch the ground and then come right back up. Be straight in your prostrations and let none of you make sajda like the dog sits. The dog sits with his elbow and his forearm and his paw on the ground. The sajda of the believer should be that his palms of his hands are on the ground, but his wrists, his forearms, his elbows are off the ground. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أمرنا أن نسجد على سبع أعظم ولا نكف ثوبا ولا شعرا. Ibn Abbas رضي الله عنهما, he narrated that the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, we've been ordered to prostrate on seven bones and to not tuck up our clothes or our hair. And this hadith is in Sahih al-Bukhari. The seven bones for sajda is the forehead and the nose. If the nose does not touch the ground, you have no sajda. It cannot just be the forehead on the ground, it has to be the forehead and the nose. And the two palms of the hands, but not the wrist or the forearm or the ankles. The Prophet ﷺ, you used to see the whiteness of his armpits when he was in sajda, because they were away from his body. Now when you're in congregational salah, it's tight, you're going to be a little closer. Your wrist, your forearm, your elbow should not be on the ground. This was a command of our Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the two palms of the hands and the fingers, the forehead and the nose, the knees and the toes, preferably bent facing the qibla. These are the seven bones we were commanded to prostrate on. We were ordered to prostrate on. And he said to not, we were also commanded to not tuck up our clothes. So in salah, to not have your shirts tucked in, to not have your sleeves rolled up in the prayer, and to not have your hair tied. For those who have longer hair from the men, that they would take it out of a hair tie if that was in a ponytail or whatever those lights are, that you would take it out for salah. This is in the salah. These are from the ways we were commanded to make sujood, to prostrate to Allah.
So let us implement the sunnah of our Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم إن الله أن يغفر لكم ذنوبكم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونصلي ونسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا وبعد. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, the Salah is the pillar of Islam, of that Tawheed. The first action will be asked about on the day of resurrection. And our Prophet, he commanded us, صلوا كما رأيتموني أصلي, pray as you have seen me praying. And the according to Ibn al-Qayyim, what he said, أعظم الركن, الأركان, the greatest of the pillars of the Salah is the Sajda. So we must know its value, not rush during it, worship our Lord in it, make dua in it, and also do it the way the Prophet ﷺ did it. And this is for the men and the women the same way. Because many of the women, they're instructed to make Sajda differently because of the way people are thinking. The women should make sajda just as the men do, because there's nothing in Sharia to differentiate it. عن ابن مسعود عن أبي مسعود عن أبو مسعود رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لا تجزئ صلاة لا يقيم الرجل فيها صلبه في الركوع والسجود. رواه النسائي, وهذا حديث صحيح. The Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, no prayer is valid, the prayer is not acceptable in the prayer in which the man or the woman does not maintain his back at ease when bowing and prostrating. Meaning you don't reach the place of ruku', calmly letting your bones settle. And we see this unfortunately daily, and we just shake our heads and we don't want to look. But the brother or the sister may be rushing in their prayer, because this hadith proves that it won't be accepted potentially. And Allah is the only one who can grade that. Don't rush in your prayers. The Prophet ﷺ, when he told the man who prayed badly, ارجح فصلي فإنك لم تصلي, go back and pray for you haven't prayed, because it was incorrect. And he said, this is what I know to do. The Prophet ﷺ, he said, when you come to the prayer, say takbirat al-ihram, read Surah al-Fatiha from what is easy from the Quran, ثم أركع حتى تطمئن راكعا, make ruku' till you are sure you're in that position, your back parallel to the ground, flat, so much so that if water was poured on it, it wouldn't run, and you're leaning against your knees, your legs should be as straight as possible, physically capable, if you're capable of that. ثم ارفع حتى تطمئن قائما حتى تعتدل قائما, then stand up until you're sure that you're straight. And we see many people come up from ruku' and it's a swaying motion and they're right back into sajda. ثم اسجد حتى تطمئن ساجدا, then go into sajda until you're sure and you're in sajda. Those seven bony areas touching the ground, you're sure, take a deep breath, then begin your subhana rabbi al-a'la and the likes of that, and make dua. ثم اجلس حتى تطمئن جالسا, and then sit between the sajda until you're sure you're in a state of sitting and your bones settle and you're calm, saying رَبَّ اغْفِرْ لِي, saying my Lord forgive me, my Lord forgive me. ثم اسجد حتى تطمئن ساجدا, and then make sajda again for a second time till you're sure you're in that. فافعل ذلك في صلاتك كلها, and then do the same way in all of your prayers, in all of your prayers. And this was the command of our Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. عن أبو سعيد رضي الله عنه قال سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول يكشف ربنا عن ساقه فيسجد له كل مؤمن ومؤمنة ويبقى من كان يسجد في الدنيا رياء وسمعة فيذهب ليسجد فيعود ظهره طبقا واحدة. رواه البخاري. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was heard to have said, Allah will bring forth in the severest hour all of the people, then the believers, the men and the women, will prostrate themselves before Allah Azza wa Jal. But there will be those who used to prostrate in this world, but for showing off, or so they could gain a good reputation with the people. Such people, they will try to make sajda on that day, but their back will be made into one bone, into one vertebrae, and they will not be able to make sajda. Be mindful of this, so you're not of this group who maybe does sajda in this life, but you can't do it on the day of resurrection. Revive the sunnah of sajda to shukr, the sajda of thankfulness.
The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he prostrated frequently in response to a blessing that came to him. When he had a blessing come to him or some good news, he would prostrate thanking Allah. عن أبي بكرة رضي الله عنه عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أنه كان إذا جاءه أمر سرور أو بشر به خر ساجدا شاكرا لله. Abu Bakr, he narrates that when something came to the Prophet ﷺ which caused him pleasure or by which made him glad, he prostrated himself in gratitude to Allah. And this hadith is sahih in the Sunnah of Ibn Majah of Abi Dawood. Thabit, he narrated from Anas radiallahu anhu that Anas used to say that in the salah, when he would come up from ruku' and stand, he would stand so long that the people would say, قَدْ نَسِي. They would think he forgot, he has to go into sajda. And yet again, there's those who come up from ruku' and right away they're going into sajda. And there will be some in his salah, you will see in the salah, the Prophet ﷺ and the sahaba, they would make sajda and sit up for the sitting between the two sajdas. And some of the people would say, قَدْ نَسِي. He forgot to make the second sajda because his sitting was so long. The two sajdas and the sitting between them in the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ are equal. Yet we see all of these things being rushed amongst the people. And Ibn Abbas رضي الله عنهما قال, فأما الركوع فعاظموا فيه الرب وأما السجود فاجتهدوا في الدعاء. Ibn Abbas رضي الله عنه, he reported that the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, in ruku' glorify your Lord, praise Him. Praise Him, don't rush while you're in it. And in sajda, in sujood, exert yourself in supplication and making dua because they're liable of being accepted. عن قتادة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أسوأ الناس سرقة الذي يسرق من صلاته. قالوا يا رسول الله كيف يسرق من صلاته؟ قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لا يتم ركوعها ولا صلاته ولا سجودها. رواه أحمد. In this hadith which is authentic in the Muslim Imam Ahmad, the Prophet ﷺ said, the worst thief is the one who steals from his prayer. The companion said, how can someone steal from their salah? The Prophet ﷺ said, they do not fulfill their ruku' and their sujood. Remember, iqam as-salah is the one who established this prayer in its time, doing the ruku' and the sujood and the prayer correctly, with khushu' and with humility. Because the performers, فَوَيْلٌ لِلْمُصَلِّينَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنْ صَلَاتِهِمْ سَهُونَ. The performers of the prayer, wail, humiliation, may befall on them yawm al-qiyamah. Jahannam may be their abode. Why? Because they were sahoon with respect to the salah. They prayed them outside of their times and with no attention to them. He does not fulfill his ruku' or his sujood. The Prophet ﷺ, he forbade that we should peck in sujood, in the salah, like a crow pecks eating the seeds off of the ground. This was forbidden from us. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, Uthman ibn Abi Dahsha, he said, I never prayed a salah except that I asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive my shortcomings in the salah. This was his statement. And I'll end with this narration from Zayd ibn Wahab, where he reported that we were once sitting in the masjid with Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman and radiallahu anhu, and a man entered from the gates of Kinda, and he stood to pray. And he prayed, and Hudhayfa, he saw him praying. And when the man was done, he came and Hudhayfa asked him, how long have you been praying in this manner that you just prayed? He said, for 40 years. Hudhayfa, he said to him, you have not prayed one prayer in your 40 years. And if you were to die praying in this manner, you would die upon a fitra other than the way of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, ikhwani wa akhwati fillah, the salah, especially that sajda, cherish it, love it, turn to it, rely on it. That should be your source of peace, your source of comfort, your source of security and happiness. Praise and thank Allah for it. Beg Allah that you will always be in a position to make sajda to Him. Treasure the gift of sajda and the gift of salah, and call upon Allah in your sujood. Praise Him and glorify Him and make dua to Him and base in that position of being the closest you can be to your Lord Azza wa Jalla while you're still on this earth. Making sajda to Him. Stop rushing your sujood and your ruku' and your prayers. Do them, learn the manners of the Prophet ﷺ and pray how he prayed. So you can be, we can be, of his ummah, yawm al-qiyamah. اللهم اغفر للمسلمين والمسلمات المؤمنين والمؤمنات الاحياء منهم والاموات انك انت سميع قريب مجيب الدعوات يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبنا على دينك يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبنا على دينك يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبنا على دينك اللهم اعز الاسلام والمسلمين وانصرنا على اعدائك واعداء الدين اللهم انصر اخواننا واخواتنا في فلسطين اللهم ثبت اقدامهم ونكس قلوبهم واغفر امواتهم واشف مرضاهم وتقبل شهداءهم يا ارحم الراحمين سبحان ربك رب العزه عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى اله وصحبه اجمعين.